Somebody would lift their hands and give God some glory. Come on now. Come on. What a powerful name it is. Come on now. It doesn't matter where you come from. What matters is where you're going in Jesus Christ. Come on now. Hallelujah. What a powerful name it is. Come on, church. Pray with me. Father God, in Jesus' name, Lord. God, we magnify the name which is above every name, God. That every knee shall bow and every tongue confess to the glory of God, Lord. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the spirit of worship in this house, God. The spirit of freedom, God. Oh, Jesus, God, I magnify you. Hide me behind the cross, Lord God. I lift you up, God. I pray for your anointing. I pray for a sinner in the house, God, that doesn't know the Savior. Draw them home, God, Lord. I pray for the backslider, God, that's walking away from God, Lord. We welcome the prodigal in this house, God. God, I pray for marriages and families and homes, God. I believe the captives have come to be set free by the blood of the Lamb. And Father, I decree and declare your blessing, God, because I believe in life, which is above, in the name of every name, in Jesus' name. And the whole church say it, amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Look at your neighbor, say, it's almost fall. It's almost fall. Hallelujah. I told the first service, I said, this is my first full year in Columbia. It has been hot. Lord, have mercy. It's hot in Columbia, boy. I'm always praising God for some good air conditioning, boy. I am looking forward to some fall-like temperatures. It's been feeling good outside in the mornings. I think we're going to go back to 90 degrees, but I always look forward to cooler temperatures. If you got your Bibles this morning, turn to Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9. The title of my message this morning is Destiny in Damascus. Destiny in Damascus. Acts 9, and beginning in verse 10. I should have it up on the screen. I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version. Now there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him the Lord said in a vision, Ananias. And he said, here I am, Lord. So the Lord said to him, arise and go to the street called Straight, and inquire of the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he is praying, and in a vision he has seen a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him so that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he has, and here he has the authority from the chief priest to bind all who call on your name. But the Lord said to him, go, for he is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how many things he must suffer for my name's sake. Verse 17. And Ananias went his way and entered the house. And laying hands on him, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you came, has sent me that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Verse 18, my last verse. Immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales, and he received his sight at once, and he arose and was baptized. Can you say amen to the reading of God's word? The number of people baptized over a major evangelistic series in Rwanda has reached 97,344 and is expected to top 100,000 this weekend. A church leader said, we are witnessing the largest baptism in the history of the denomination. Dwayne McKee, a key coordinator on the May 13th through the 28th meetings, McKee noted that the goal of the local church leaders had been 60,000 baptisms, or 30 people at each of the roughly 2,200 meeting sites across the African country. The prayer goal, however, was 100,000. It is expected that that goal will be reached by this weekend, he said. Praise God, local church leaders had counted 95,890 baptisms by the end of the meetings on May 28th, a figure that already dwarfed the previous record of 30,000 baptisms after a countrywide evangelistic series in Zimbabwe in May of 2015. It's powerful. Could you imagine 100,000 baptisms? That just blows my mind. Peter only baptized 3,000 in the book of Acts, chapter 2. It's something about the heart of God that speaks to baptism. It's in the mind of God. It's in the heart of God. It's in the Word of God. It's something we're commanded to do in Scripture. It's something supernatural that takes place. If any of you have been there before, been baptized, you know exactly what I'm talking about. It's something about just being in those waters, amen? Well, let's begin to unpack our text a little bit. I love verse-by-verse preaching, so let me unpack our text. Now, there was a certain disciple of Damascus named Ananias. And to him the Lord said in a vision, Ananias. Ananias' name means to whom Jehovah has graciously been given. See, we need an Ananias in our life. Ananias in our life is those people that come along when we're young and in the faith, or we're getting ready to step into the faith. We need that Ananias. I think about a youth pastor as a young man, as I first attended a Pentecostal church around the age of 15. Little Church of God over there down from my high school, and I was in for a rude awakening. Hallelujah. Somebody know what I'm talking about. Amen. I had only been to Baptist, Methodist churches like that. All of a sudden, I walked in a Pentecostal church. I was like, man, these folks are crazy. But something deep in my heart wanted what they've had. And that youth pastor was an Ananias in my life. He was considered what I considered a devout Christian at the high school, and he began to mentor me into speaking, and he invited me to come to church. I just went to play basketball and baseball with my buddies, but God was doing something great in my life through that revelation, Ananias in our life. We need those in our life. You don't forsake those, and you accept those Ananiases in your life. Ananias was the one that said, here I am, Lord. Isaiah said, here I am, Lord, send me. There was something about to take place. Look at verse 11. And the Bible says, to a street called Straight, to a man that was wicked. See, we need to understand that we need to have some straight things in our life. If I could get a little focused on what I'm talking about right here. We need sometimes that somebody take us down the straight road or the narrow road as it comes with Scripture. We need preaching that steps on our toes. Tells us right and wrong, good and evil, holiness and sinful, amen? We need that type of stuff. We need the narrow path. We need to know the Word of God. Matthew 7:14 says, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and few that find it. Ananias was going down the straight road to find a wicked man that lived for himself, as we call Saul of Tarsus, that he might receive his sight. Physically, watch, yes, but spiritually as well. Helen Keller said it like this, the only thing worse than being born blind is having sight and no vision. Not being able to see ahead, not being able to look ahead, only can see the temporal and not the eternal. We need to see the greater. He come to receive his sight, as it says in verse 12. That's the thing, is we need to be able to see again. We need to know that Satan blinds the eyes. Amen. As we're going to unpack that later in my message. Satan closes off the eyes. He blinds the eyes to block us from seeing correctly or biblically. Because while we are all about ourselves and all about us, and everything centers around us. Look at verse 13. Then Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem." Well, who's the many? The Bible doesn't tell us who the many is. We call this gossip. We call this slander. We call this, the word around town is about this man. Everybody knows who Saul is. Everybody knows his reputation. That's the reason why oftentimes God will call people out of the crowd, like the drunk or the alcoholic, to get them baptized. He'll pull them out of the crowd. He'll pull them out amongst the people, the religious community. We've heard the reputation. We've heard the word around town about this Saul of Tarsus. We've heard his name. But see, Paul needed Ananias, and Ananias needed Paul. What do you mean, Pastor? See, oftentimes that the longer we're saved, the longer we're sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost, we need to remember where we come from. So we need a Saul conversion to take place at the altar. We need that drunk to encounter God, and we need to see it. We need that person that has been through a serious trial in their life to lift their hands, and we can look beside us and say, wait a minute. I can lift my hands too because God has been good to me. Amen. God has been faithful to me. So Paul needed Ananias as much as Ananias needed Paul. I've heard his reputation. I've heard everything about this man. But Ananias still went forward. Look at verse 15. He says, "But the Lord said to me, 'Go, for he is a chosen vessel of mine.'" I like that. Chosen vessel. He now belongs to me. He doesn't belong to the Pharisees or the Sadducees. He doesn't belong to that community. He doesn't belong to the Torah scholars. He doesn't belong to none of those. He's mine now. Hallelujah. Can anybody say that the Lord belongs to you? Amen. Or you belong to the Lord. Hallelujah. My life is not my own. Amen. He said he's my chosen vessel. It doesn't matter what the world has said. It doesn't matter what the gossip around town is. I have chosen this man. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad that God still chooses you? Aren't you glad that God still calls you out amongst in sin, amongst in deliverance? God says, "I've chosen you. I've ordained you. I've set you as a prophet unto the nations according to Scripture." It's kind of like our children. No matter how much they do, no matter how much wrong they do, they're still our babies, amen? They're still our family. They're still our kin, and we're still going to stick by their side. God says, "This is my man now. He's been adopted into the family. He's been radically changed. I'm going to have something supernatural take place in his life." God says he belongs to me. Look at verse 15 again. It talks about the name before my name. I preached on it years ago. I said there was power in a name. Because, see, a name held reputation around town. Kind of like, you know who the local drunk is. You know who the local prostitute is. You know who the local crackhead is. Why? Because their name has preceded their reputation. Well, it was even worse 2,000 years ago, because that oftentimes flowed into your children and your grandchildren. There was power in a name. But see, that Roman citizens had three names: a forename, a family name, and a personal name. A slave would oftentimes take on the name of his master. I cannot see in Scripture, as I begin to study it, that where God changed his name as much as Saul changed his name to Paul. Acts 13:9, they didn't have this verse, but it says, "Then Saul, who also is called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked intently at him." See, Paul knew he had a new master. Paul knew a radical conversion was about to take place. Watch this. The name Saul means desired. The name Paul means small. He was desired in the community. He had the reputation. He had the scholarship. He had the notoriety, per se. He had all this going for him. He was desired. The people of the community, most of them, wanted his position or his status. He was desired. But Paul says, "I no longer want to be desired by the world's standards. I want to be small by God's standards." John 3:30. "He must increase and I must decrease. It's all about Him, and it's not about me. God will share His glory with no man. You know what I'm talking about. See, Paul understood something at the conversion that took place. I no longer want the things of this world. I want the righteousness of God. Well, were there people that were changed in the Bible by conversion and name? Absolutely. Jacob became Israel. The liar, the deceiver, the backstabber, the swindler became Israel. But we still call it the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Abram became Abraham, the father of many. Simon became Peter, which we shall build this rock upon his church. Amen. There was radical name change, but Paul said, I'm going to change my name because I want to be small in my eyes, but be lifted up high in His. There was something that takes place because he knew it was not about him. You go up under that water in baptism. Spiritually, there's a name change that takes place because you no longer desire the old life. You no longer live by that name, even though that name may have a reputation. I've told you before is that when somebody comes up to you and says, I remember what you did, you can say, well, you know what I've been forgiven for. You know what I've been redeemed from. Amen. Give him some praise. I like this. Look at verse 17. Let's keep on going. And Ananias went his way and entered the house and laying his hands on him and said, Brother Saul. Wait a minute. Brother Saul? Don't we say that in the house of God? Sister so-and-so? Brother so-and-so? So guess what, my friend? You're in the family now. Hallelujah. You've been adopted. You're no longer Saul of Tarsus. You're Brother Saul. Amen? Now you're adopted into the family. Now you have a name change. Now you're in the family of God. Amen? You're no longer cast aside. You're no longer rejected. You're no longer going on your way to hell, but you have the hope of heaven. Now you're in the family. Amen? It's something about family. Hallelujah. Well, let me look at Paul's pedigree. He was a Pharisee. He was a tent maker. He was an evangelist. He was a missionary. He was a scripture writer. His mentor was Rabbi Gamaliel. He had 13 New Testament letters, possibly 60 to 80 churches founded under his leadership. He led thousands to Jesus Christ. Philippians 1:12. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that this was what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. Well, let's do a little math here. If he sits in prison for maybe 3 years, maybe longer, because when he wrote Philippians, he was in jail. If you take a Roman guard and change him out every 6 to 8 hours, you could imagine the amount of people that he shared the gospel with. If this was an advance, this was Paul's pedigree. Look at Philippians 3. He also says this. They'll bring this up on the screen. Though I have might confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks that he might have confidence in the flesh, I more so. What do you know what he's saying? I could brag more than you could. If anybody could, circumcised on the 8th day, according to Jewish law, the word of God told him to do that. The stock of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, watch, a Hebrew of the Hebrews. Concerning the law, a Pharisee. I've obeyed the law. I fulfilled the 613 commands of Scripture in the Torah. Concealing zeal, I had the passion. Persecuting the church, I thought what I did was right. But it was actually wrong. Concerning the righteous, which is in the law, blameless. I fulfilled all these things. If anybody can say that a narcissist, Paul is saying it could be me. I could brag more than anybody, but I don't want none of that stuff anymore. I no longer want to live by that name. I want to live by a new name. If anybody thought they had figured it out, if anybody lived by the Torah, if anybody had done all those things, it was me, is what Paul was saying. But I want to live for Jesus Christ and I want to be baptized. Well, let me give you the equivalent of the Apostle Paul in our generation. Mossab Hassan Youssef was the son of a Hamas terrorist and his father was the founder of the Muslim Brotherhood, a young man who grew up in Ramallah, Israel, which is near Bethlehem. He had 5 brothers and 3 sisters and he was the oldest. He was taught Jews and Christians were the enemies. Well, where does that name Hamas come from? Some of you don't even realize this. Genesis 6:11, the earth was corrupt before God and the earth was filled with violence. Violence means Hamas. The man that grew up in a family of terrorists. The man that was supposed to pass on the torch. The father was passing on the torch to the son, watch, to grow up to become a terrorist. He was invited by a cab driver in Israel to come to church, even when he didn't even speak good English. And they gave him a Bible in Arabic and English. He eventually became a believer in Jesus Christ. He is the equivalent of the Apostle Paul. He wrote a book called The Son of Hamas. Could you imagine growing up in this environment? You are bred to kill Christians and Jews. You are bred to do these things. And he began to ask questions of his father. He began to discern, and you can look up his testimony. It's powerful. He began to want to know all these things. He would go in and do what he was told to do, to take out innocent lives, because this was something indoctrinated in him. And all of a sudden, this, what some would say would be a coincidence, we say it was God, that met a cab driver from England driving in Israel to hand him a Bible just at the right time. He was radically changed. He was so radically changed to begin to share his story, begin to pour out, begin to write books, and shares his testimony. Christians begin to hear of his name. And they didn't want him to come to the church. They were afraid because of his background. I want you to understand Saul of Tarsus. This is exactly who Saul of Tarsus was. He was the example of Musab, Hassan, Yusef. He was that man in that generation. I want you to understand it from nuts and bolts in a 2019 language. He went into the house of God and he would attack this preacher, attack our pastor, and begin to wreak havoc upon the services. Drag them out by their hair. Pull them out. And this is exactly what this young man was trained to do, and they tried to cast him aside. When you begin to understand who this man was and understand his life, then you can understand what the conversion that took place at Damascus. That's the reason why I called my title Destiny at Damascus. Because something powerful was taking place. God had set everything up. He thought he was doing God's work by wreaking havoc on the church. He was concerning zeal, as we read in the passage. He thought he was doing God's work, but he wasn't. So why baptism? Why was Paul baptized? Well, let me go a little deeper with that. I'm going to give you some text here, and I want you to write these down if you can. Romans 6:4, therefore we are buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should also walk in newness of life. Somebody said, why immersion or going under the water and not sprinkling? Well, can I look at it from his death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord? Death to sin. You got to let sin die. You go up under that water, you are saying, I'm no longer a slave to sin. I no longer want to live the sinful life. I no longer want these things. That must die. I come across people, I said this in the first service, that they begin to share their testimony, and I've heard hundreds of them. I don't know exactly over the years I've been in ministry. And I heard several of them have said in the past that they would begin to talk about their old life and their life of sin, and they would say, those were the good old days. I said, well, then you haven't met Jesus yet. You don't know the God I serve, because now are the great days. Hallelujah. Amen. See, I want that old life to die. I want that death to sin, because sin must die. Watch this. The Spirit lives, according to Romans. I no longer want, I choose to go up under that water because I acknowledge that I die to sin. I set aside that sin that so easily besets me. So I die to sin in his death. Romans 6:1-2. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer? I no longer want that old side. I let my sin die. I don't take advantage of the grace of God, but I live through the Spirit of God. Well, what about his burial? I bury the old life. I go up under that water, the symbol of his grave. I've been to the tomb twice. It's still empty. Hallelujah. What's your old life? What's that life that you hold on to? You bury that old life. You no longer want that life. It doesn't matter the name that followed that old life. Some people know where you came from. Sometimes it's even the ones you love. They know exactly what you did. Why? Because some of them helped raise you and they were around you for 30 to 40 years. They know exactly, but you bury the old life. I don't want that life no more. I'm going for the new life in Christ. Colossians 2:12, buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised through him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. I choose to bury that old life. I've told this before and I say this many times. If somebody comes up to you and says, I remember what you did, say, great, you know what I've been forgiven for. Because it's not about me anymore. It's not about my righteousness. Because as Pastor said, this is not a perfect church, but we serve a perfect God. Come on now. We serve a perfect God. So I choose to bury the old life. I choose to say I no longer want that life. And then his resurrection. He was raised to life. Victorious life. Hallelujah. Colossians 3. If you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. I am raised to life. I'm a Pentecostal preacher. I believe that the power that rose Jesus from the grave 2,000 years ago is alive today. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Oh, Jesus, I remember when I was in Israel, and on the second trip I went, that word got around that I was the pastor, one of the pastors. It don't take long when you got our Christians. They point out, they find the pastor. Well, there were several of us, and they said, Pastor, we need help baptizing people in the Jordan. Will you help us? I was like, yes, absolutely I will. Sign me up. And I remember going down in the waters, and I had my robe on. I changed clothes, and I remember as they lined up, hundreds of them, black, white, Hispanic, Japanese, Korean, Indonesian, I could go on and on. And it was powerful because as they began to come down into the water, and I knew none of these people, many of them began to speak in tongues. The Spirit of the living God had drawn them down, and God was doing a great work. So God was baptizing his people right there. And it was amazing because I saw a vision of heaven right there through that. Because that's the reason I've told you before, if you've got a spirit of racism, you better break that over your life in the name of Jesus. Because God loves all people from all backgrounds. He wants to baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Baptism in the ancient Middle East, Pastor has mentioned this before, was a death sentence. Or a lifelong of suffering. Let me read some scripture to you of what Paul had to suffer. From the Jews, 2 Corinthians 11, they'll bring that up on the screen. From the Jews, 5 times I received 40 stripes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. 1 night and 1 day I have been in the deep, in journeys, often in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of Gentiles, in perils of the city, in perils of the wilderness, in perils of the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and toil and sleepless, often in hunger and thirst and fastings, and often in cold and nakedness. See, Paul knew what persecution is like because he had stood into the baptism waters. I no longer want to be desired by the world, but I want to live for Jesus Christ. And now we're blessed because of his writings. He was whipped with 39 lashes 5 times. Beaten with rods, hidden with stones, shipwrecked, adrift at sea, sleepless nights, hungry and thirsty, cold and exposed. Anybody that tells you that everything's just going to be all right and everything's going to be perfect if you follow Jesus Christ, they've lied to you. They've deceived you. Because you will suffer persecution because of your stance for God. You can watch TV and you notice that the media and most of the world around us is anti-God. Amen. They no longer stand for the Word of God. Righteousness and holiness, they attack you. I had a dream probably about a month ago that I went to prison for preaching the gospel. And I was telling my wife to come visit me. Could that day come? I don't know. Maybe. It already takes place in certain countries around the world. Could it come to America? If anything I want to go to jail for is preaching the gospel. Hallelujah. Because I stand for righteousness and holiness. So persecution will come, but greater is me that is in me than he that is in the world. Almost everything that the apostle did, to the church oftentimes came back to him. Wasn't it the same man that watched the stoning of Stephen in Acts chapter 7? He did all these things, but I don't want to be desired of the world. I want to be small in the eyes of God. The story is told about the baptism of King Agnes by St. Patrick in the middle of the 5th century. Sometime during the ceremony, St. Patrick leaned on his sharp, pointed staff and inadvertently stabbed the king's foot. After the baptism was over, St. Patrick looked down at the blood and realized what he had done and begged the king's forgiveness. "Why did you suffer this pain in silence?" the saint wanted to know. The king replied, "I thought it was part of the ritual. I thought it was normal. There's some pain associated with it because the old life has to die." Amen. There's some pain. I've got to repent. I've got to turn. I've got to reject the old life of sin. There's some pain in there because I want to live for the holiness and the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to live for God. I don't care what the world thinks. I want God. And I'm willing to go in front of my church. I'm willing to go under those waters. I'm willing to jobs. I'm willing to be rejected and despised by the ones I love, even if it takes that I have the hope of heaven in Jesus. Amen. Baptism basically means to me a life of obedience. Well, why don't people get baptized? John 3 tells us, "And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil." They didn't want the light, and they still don't. That's the reason why people don't repent. That's the reason why people don't want to get baptized, because they love the darkness. They don't want the things of their life coming into the light. Baptism says, "I'm telling the world, all of me, 100% of me is coming into the light, is coming into the glory of God. I give all of myself to you, God. I've been rejected. I've lived the life of sin. I'm letting it all out in front of you. I'm airing my dirty laundry," per se. Verse 18, "Immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales." Like I said before, Satan blinds the eyes. 2 Corinthians 4:4, "Whose minds the God of this age are blinded, who do not believe, lest the light shine of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them." They could no longer, this is the reason why, stop trying to convince the world to understand what you believe. They're not supposed to understand you. They haven't confessed Jesus as Lord. They haven't went into the baptism waters. They don't understand what God has done in your life. You can give them your testimony. Absolutely, you should. But they will not understand you until they partake in it. That's the reason why you're going to be rejected and sometimes despised. But you're also going to be accepted in the eyes of God. Hallelujah. Come on, give him some praise. Man will judge Paul before Damascus. God will judge him after it. I can't speak for my old life. That's buried. That's gone. But I can speak for the life that came after the blood and after the water. Then I can testify of God's goodness. Then I can brag on God, because it doesn't matter where I came from. What matters is where I'm going in Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, have mercy. How much time do I got? About 40 more minutes. Hallelujah. 1 Timothy 1:15. "This is the faithful saying and worthy of acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, who I am chief." I'm at the front of the line is what he's saying. I could brag because I have been there and done that. I've got the t-shirt. I am the chief. But guess what? If we're honest, we need to raise our hands and say, "I am chief as well at being sinner." It's because of his blood, because of his water. Acts 9, in verse 20, look at this. Jumps ahead a little bit with my text. "Immediately he preached Christ in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God." He persecuted Christ. Now he's preaching Christ. Not everybody's called to be a pastor, but everybody's called to be an evangelist and share the gospel, amen, to share the good news to the world. He immediately preached Christ. "I've had this reputation. I've had my word. Everything about me has been exposed. But now I just want to brag on God. Now I want to talk about his goodness." The Bible says he will use the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. Watch this. Maybe he understood his foolishness. Maybe he understood where he came from. That's the reason why we walk into the waters. I don't want the old life no more, God. I was a young man, probably a year or two married. And the pastor was doing a Sunday night service. He said, "Who wants to be baptized?" I knew I'd never been into those waters. And I remember they forgot to turn the heater on in the baptism waters. Lord have mercy. I stepped in the water and I told on the microphone, I told the whole church, I said, "This is like the Jordan right now. It's cold." And I got up there, little small little church, me and Courtney together. And I went up under them waters, freezing and cold. I come up a new man in Christ. Those waters remind me that the life of sin, the life of death, the life of chaos, the life that I had no more was no longer my life. I was now blood-bought, sanctified, Holy Ghost-filled, baptized in the Spirit of the living God, because now He is my Lord and my Savior. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus God. 2 Timothy says it like this. He said, "For am I already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand." He's about to wrap it up. Church history tells us he had his head cut off. If you study church history, "I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there lays a crown of righteousness, which is the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not to me only, but also to also who love his appearing." Hallelujah. Acts 9 is where it started. 2 Timothy 4 is where it ended. He fought the good fight. There's a spiritual war going on. If you stick your head in the sand, it doesn't deny the fact that Satan wants your soul. I'm telling you, as honest as I can be, as one of your pastors, Satan seeks to devour you and take you to the pits of hell. He's trying to annihilate you and your family. If you stick your head in the sand, you are denying the very Word of God, because it's in the Word of God. There's a spiritual war. You step out in that lake, you step out in that water, you're going for God, because you're sold for Jesus Christ. Watch this. He finished the race. I ran my own course. I'm not competing against you. You're not competing against me as one of your preachers. I ran my course. I have fought the fight. I have ran my course. He kept the faith. I kept my trust in God. I don't understand why I had to go through all these things and be persecuted. I don't understand why I was beaten and tortured in jail, in prison. I don't understand those things. Why you got to fight cancer, diseases, and all those things. I don't understand. But my faith is in trusting God. My faith is in trusting a living God that I'm going to keep the faith. Because my Acts 9 began at that church in the waters. I don't know when I'm going to write my 2 Timothy. That's up to God. But in the meantime, I'm going to give Him everything that I've got with a crazy Holy Ghost passion. I'm going to give God, I'm going to hit the ground running, and I'm going to fight that old devil and know that we're going to bring souls into the kingdom of God. Watch this. And He gained the crown of righteousness. I made it to heaven. I finally made it. I had to see all these things. They devastated me and they hurt me. But I was willing to know that I remember stepping in those waters. I remember stepping out in the lake with my pastor. I remember stepping in the baptismal waters. I remember when I told the world I'm going for God. And my reward is streets of gold. My reward is a mansion made in heaven. Amen. Stand with me over the house. I'm wondering today, say, "You know what, preacher, I've never been baptized." Put your name on the list and me and pastor will baptize you. Declare to this church. Declare to social media. Declare to the world, "I'm going for God." I'm not holding back. I'm giving it everything that I've got. I'm laying it all out. Stop riding the fence. Jesus didn't ride no fence. He rode a donkey. Get off that fence. Stop playing the fence. Go for God. Be sold out. I've told you before, I'm the least unqualified person to be preaching this gospel. The son of two teenage parents, I should not be standing before a 500-member congregation. Never in my life would I know that God would choose a boy coming from a broken home, baptize me in those waters to stand before this congregation. I'm the least qualified. But Jesus has changed my life, and I serve Him. So I will honorably baptize you. I will do anything, but you have to make that decision. Let the old life go. I want God in my life. I told my family as a young man, because I felt the call to ministry, honestly, when I was about 8 years old. I've told you before, some of you had went to that little Baptist church, and they would use me in little things in ministry. I oftentimes would stand by the door, and I'd hold the offering plate as an eight-year-old boy, and they would come by, and they'd drop their offering in the offering plate. I'd be standing there by myself, no other family, just me. They'd say, "Thank you, young man. Good job, young man." They would praise me. That's when I first felt the call of God. Well, I didn't have no real mentor teaching me the things of God. I had family that loved me, but they weren't teaching me the principles of Scripture. That's when I first felt it. I didn't understand it. I was a child, about 18, 19 years old. When I started going back to church again, the Pentecostal church, I knew. I said, "God, I'm the least likely to step in those waters, God." And God brought me back to the Apostle Paul. I stand before you today because you got to know my story, as Pastor said. You got to know where God has done in my life. But if I brag, I'm going to brag in Him. My righteousness is not my own. My righteousness is in the blood of the Lamb. My righteousness is in His name's sake. So I stand before you, a sinner saved by grace. And I'm wondering, is that you today? Say, "You know what, preacher, I need prayer today. I'm backsliding. I'm drifting from God. I need people in my family that need to know this God. I need people in my family that need to be baptized. I need people in my family that need to do the things of God." Step out in faith as I begin to pray and they begin to play worship. Say, "I want to go for God. And I don't care who knows it." Because like I told my family when I felt the call to ministry, some of them laughed at me. They said, "It's a phase. It'll fade out. It's just, he's just experimenting. He's young. He's immature. He doesn't know what he's doing." Well, I can say 20 years later, I've led many of them to Christ. Those same ones that didn't understand and mocked me. I was a young man. It almost devastated me. It took a lot out of me. But now I've sat in their hospital rooms and held their hands and prayed with them as they fought cancer, as they went through devastation, and say, "You know what? There is a God that loves you. You know where I came from because you saw me as a little boy growing up. You saw all the errors and my mistakes. You saw all my sins. You saw all those things, but I want to introduce you to my friend. God that gave His Son, His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. I want to introduce you to Him." And I sat by their bedside and I introduced many of them to Jesus. So that's what I want for you today. Say, "You know what, preacher? I want to come pray this morning. I'm ready to step out in the waters. I'm ready to go to the lake with you next week. It may be hot, that's fine. But we're going to have plenty of food to eat. We'll stuff your belly and then throw you up under the water." Hallelujah. And then you can go home knowing that you declared to this church, to the world, to everybody, "I'm going for God." Father God, in Jesus' name, Lord. Father, I welcome the Holy Spirit in this house, God. God, draw them down to the altar. Draw them to the lake, God. Draw them into the baptismal waters like the Apostle Paul, God. God, maybe they're ashamed of the old life. Maybe they've done some things they don't want to tell nobody about. But we welcome the God of heaven, the God that redeems, the God of salvation, the God that pursued me when I was coming from a parent, coming from teenage parents, God, coming from a broken home where I saw drugs, drinking, alcohol. I saw all that stuff, God. But God, you love me enough to send your only begotten Son. The God that shed his blood for me on a Roman cross. The God that died for me and rose again, God. I want to walk out to that lake, God. And I want to step out into the waters. Is that you today? In Jesus' name. Come on, can we just take a few moments and we lift our hands. Oh, God, we welcome the Spirit of the living God. I believe lives are being changed today, God. I can sense it, God. God, you make us clean. Come on, sing it, church. To go outside and we would play in the mud, the dirt, the dogs, the animals getting nasty, filthy. I loved it. Climbing trees, you name it, I've done it all. And I'd stand outside, they'd turn on the hose pipe, just wash you down. Couldn't even come inside, you know what I'm talking about. Just hose you down. Come here, boy. Like that. Just hose you down. You had mud all over you. That's how you got clean first. There's some things in your life soap and water can't clean. I don't care how much you scrub, how many baths you take, you can't clean your soul. Ask God. So look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, meet me at the lake next week. And it's time for a Holy Ghost cleansing. Hallelujah. Come on now. Let's pray. Father God, in Jesus' name, God, I pray right now. I pray for those that need to take the step of baptism. You know who they are, God. Put their name on the list, God. Draw them out, God. God, the hamburgers will feed the belly, but the waters will begin to wash the soul. And Father, I pray right now, God, your Holy Spirit, do a great work, God. I believe altars and lives are being changed today to the glory of God. For we give you all the praise and all the honor. It's in Jesus' wonderful name. And the whole church say it. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you as you go.